All right, church, how we doing? Let's stand to our feet.
You are my joy, you are my song, you are the well, the one I'm drawing from. You are my refuge, my whole life long, where else would I go? Surely my God is the strength of my soul. Your love defends me, your love defends me. And when I feel like I'm all alone, your love defends me, your love defends me. Day after day, night after night, I will remember you're with me in this fight. Although the battle rages on, the war's already won. I know the war is already won.
Church, welcome to worship tonight. Let's pray together. Lord, we thank you for that tonight. We thank you that we can meet together, we can worship together. God, we thank you for who you are, that you are our portion, that you are our salvation. God, we pray that tonight we would be encouraged by meeting together, and that we would even learn what that means in our lives, and that we would be intentional to pursue that. We love you. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Yeah. is so sweet to trust in Jesus and to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise and to know, thus says the Lord. Trust his cleansing love and in sin the feet to plunge me beneath the healing cleansing blood. Oh Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I proved him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. Yes, it is so sweet to trust in Jesus, just from sin itself to cease, just from
seated.
Good evening. I hope you're all doing well. I want to welcome a couple of guests tonight. We have Peg and Amy. Let's give these two a warm welcome, would you please? I want you to take out the inserts from your program. We are making progress. It's very, very encouraging. When we started our volunteer drive, we needed 75 volunteers to fill all the needs in our worship services, Saturday evening, two on Sunday, and now we have 44 that have been, 31 have been filled and 44 to go. So I hope you'll take some time to really pray. And this is from our ministry leaders. Let me read this to you. We have well-organized ministries that want to minister to you as you volunteer. This is from our team leader in our children's ministry, Cheryl Byers. Our volunteers are fantastic and our team leaders are fantastic, but they need your help so the teams can focus on building relationships with each other and not have to be running around and wearing lots of different hats because we don't have enough volunteers to fill all the spots. If you're going to volunteer in children's ministry, you're going to get a month on and then a month off. And the reason we do a month on is so the kids can see you consistently and build a little bit of a relationship with you. You're not just there filling a spot, but you're there ministering the scriptures to them and ministering in Jesus' name. So I hope you take some time to look this over. Again, we still need 44 spots to make our ministries run as smoothly as they did before we had to shut down. So please take some time to pray and to step up. Baptism is coming up. Some of you may be ready for that. So on the weekend of November 7th and 8th, we'll have a baptism service here in our church. And we need your paperwork. It's just a simple application. And then you meet with a pastor. And but that needs to be turned in by the 22nd of this month. Also, we're having parent and child dedications coming up on November 14th and 15th. You do need to register for a very short class. And then the dedication is actually on the 29th. The 29th of October, you need to have that class done and you need to have your paper turned in. Those details are in your program. I hope you'll take time to look those over. Congratulations to Tyler and Sarah Griggs. Their little girl's name is Millie. It's cute. And then on the other side of that spectrum, Rob and Shelley Taylor and Jen Maurer. Rob and Jen's stepdad died very suddenly, and so please keep them in your prayers. Before I pray for the offering, I just want to continue to remind you to please operate as you come into church in a responsible way, a respectful way, and a flexible way as we deal with all the fallout and all of the ramifications of this pandemic. One of the most responsible things you can do, I'm saying this with a smile, is if you're sick, stay home. We say that every year at this time because of cold and flus. It's even more important now, and we all know that. So please be responsible in that respect. Children, too. Don't take any chances, obviously. Just do that, and we'll all be better for that. Let's pray now. Lord, thank you for this weather. It's great to be out and to see the beauty of the changing leaves and see the harvest come in and just to be in this season, Lord. Thank you for that. Lord, for those in our congregation who are hurting in the hospital, dealing with this virus or some of the fallout of it, Lord, for those that are grieving the loss of loved ones, Lord, we ask for your comfort for them. Lord, we thank you for new life, the new life of Millie. Pray your blessings on her and especially Sarah as she recovers from some difficulty but is doing well. We thank you for that. So, Lord, we just want to renew our commitment to be responsible, to come here in this space and to care for one another, to lift our voices and lift our hands to you, but to take care of one another. So help us to do that, Lord, in the best way we can. Receive all of our praise, the offerings, and these requests, Lord, and may your will be done, and give us faith to see your will, and faith in our footsteps that we might follow faithfully and represent Jesus in all that we do. And all of God's people said, amen.
Jesus Christ, my sanity. Sweet Jesus Christ, my clarity. Bread of heaven broken for me. Cup of salvation held out. Jesus, mystery. Christ has died and Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Sweet Jesus Christ, my sanity. Sweet Jesus Christ, my clarity. Bread of heaven broken for me. Cup of salvation held out to drink. Jesus, mystery. Christ has died and Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Christ has died and Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Right now we're going to take 10 minutes, as we always do, to fellowship, to encourage, to get to know someone that we don't know, to just share with each other. So when you hear the music, come back to your seats, and we'll see you then.
Christ has died and Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Christ has died and Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Thank you.
Good evening, church. Dads never stop being dads, do they? My dad came up to me just now and said, make sure you introduce yourself. I said, okay. So my name is Bryce Cruz. I'm a resident here at the church. Today we're continuing our series, Stronger Together. We've had quite a few messages on this over the past few weeks. And during this series, we are examining some of the one another statements in the New Testament. Our goal for this series is that we would be reminded that we are stronger together when we are unified and participating in a community of believers. We truly are stronger, better, more equipped to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the glory of God. Not only do we want to remind you of that in a cognitive or intellectual way, we want to impress the importance of that on you. We want to urge you to actually carry these things out and practice what we're teaching in relationships. That's the series. And my verse, my one another, comes from Hebrews 3:13, if you want to turn there with me. Hebrews 3:13. A little bit of background on the book of Hebrews. It's a little bit of a mystery. Nobody knows who the author of the book of Hebrews is. Many have suggested Paul or Peter. Apollos is another biblical character who scholars have thought could have possibly wrote it. Most simply say that we just don't know. He's not named, and there's not a lot of evidence for a specific person. We also don't know who exactly the book was written to. We have a lot of letters written to specific churches, like the church at Galatia, the church at Ephesus. You see that in the names of the letters, but the book of Hebrews is written to Jews, broadly speaking, probably somewhere in the East. In fact, the book of Hebrews the purpose of it was to explain to these Jews what was required in the Old Testament, what was required under the Mosaic law, was no longer required because Jesus had perfectly and completely fulfilled that law. It was written to demonstrate that Jesus in his person was supreme, was better than Moses, was more powerful and important than Abraham and the angels and any of the other Old Testament patriarchs. In chapter 3, where we're at today, the author is in the middle of explaining that Jesus is greater and more important than Moses specifically. And that because of Jesus' greatness, because of his holiness, because of his supremacy over even Moses, who gave the law to the Jews, we should listen to him. These people should pay attention to him and what he's saying. Now we come to our verse, so if you would, read with me Hebrews 3, and we're going to start in verse 12. We're going to go through 14, verses 12 to 14. It says, "See to it, brothers and sisters, that none of you has a sinful, unbelieving heart that turns away from the living God. But encourage one another daily, as long as it is called today, so that none of you may be hardened by sin's deceitfulness. We have come to share in Christ, if indeed we hold our original conviction firmly to the very end." What I want to do today is pretty simple. I want to walk through these verses and explain them in just a little bit more detail, and then I want to give you three points, three observations from these verses, and then give you three application points at the end. That sounds simple enough, but let me tell you right now that the kind of encouragement that we see in these verses is extremely important and, in fact, is a matter of life and death. This kind of encouragement could literally save someone's life. I'll tell you a story that demonstrates just that in a little bit. First, here's my main point. This isn't one of the three points. This is just an overarching point that I see from these three verses. And the point is this, that our faith requires perseverance. And one of the ways that God helps us to persevere is the encouragement of other believers. Our faith requires perseverance, and one of the ways God helps us to persevere is the encouragement of other believers. All right, let's quickly walk through the text, starting in verse 12. Again, it says, "See to it, brothers and sisters, that none of you has a sinful, unbelieving heart that turns away from the living God." Notice the kind of heart that turns away from the living God. It is a sinful, unbelieving heart. It is the heart that does not believe God. It has rejected the gospel. This is not saying that a person who has come to a saving belief in Christ will turn away. The author here is warning us to keep a careful, loving lookout over one another to make sure that we all have true, genuine faith. As brothers and sisters, we watch out for one another, not so that we can run and tell mom and dad when one of us makes a mistake, but so that we protect each other. We don't spy, we don't babysit, we don't control, we watch out for one another to make sure that we have genuine faith. Verse 13 again says, "But encourage one another daily as it is called today, so that none of you may be hardened by sin's deceitfulness." This is one of God's antidotes to the poison of sin. This is a lighthouse of God that shines through the dark, that warns us of rocks and reefs and obstacles that could potentially sink and wreck our faith. The encouragement of other believers. The word "encourage" here has a broad range of meaning. It's translated multiple ways, like exhort or urge. We'll look at those definitions a little bit later for one of the points. Verse 14, "We have come to share in Christ if indeed we hold our original conviction firmly to the end." This is essentially a restatement of verse 12. Notice that this verse does not say that we will come to share in Christ if we hold our confidence firm to the end. Coming to share in Christ is not dependent upon our holding to it. It says we have come to share in Christ, therefore we hold our conviction to the end. Persevering is evidence and confirmation of the fact that we have been saved. This is important because encouraging one another and exhorting one another, urging one another, is a matter of life and death, and it's one of the ways God keeps us persevering. I wanted to explain all those verses and go through those in a little more detail so that we understand the seriousness of this subject, but I don't want you to get too caught up in some of the minutiae. It's not exactly what we're trying to get at. The point of explaining all this, and this is my first main point of three, is that this kind of encouragement is life and death, and that we need one another to persevere. Once again, following Christ requires perseverance. And encouragement helps us persevere by keeping us from being hardened by sin. Being involved in biblical community is a matter of life and death, because the final consequence, the final result of being deceived by sin is separation from God. When someone is totally deceived by sin, when they have been lied to and tricked, they reject God and the gospel. That's what these verses are saying. They're saying that the wicked, unbelieving heart does not seek out biblical community, does not seek out relationships, but is deceived by sin and is lost. Some people aren't deceived by their own sin only. Some people are weighed down by the sin of the world. Some people see the evil that goes on, and that is what hardens them. Sin gets to us in a lot of different ways. William Cowper was a poet in the 1700s. You may recognize that name, you may not. His most famous work is a hymn. It's called "God Moves in Mysterious Ways." Very famous hymn. If you haven't heard it, if you haven't read the lyrics, I would encourage you to look it up. It's a wonderful, wonderful hymn. But Cowper suffered from paralyzing anxiety and depression. He struggled with the brokenness around him in the world and inside of him. Over the course of his life, he attempted suicide 6 or 7 times. 3 of those being in one day where he tried to drown himself, he tried to hang himself, and then he tried to poison himself. One of the main reasons that Cooper came to faith in Christ and lived to die a natural death was the ministry of John Newton. If you know the name John Newton, you know it from the hymn Amazing Grace. He is the one who wrote Amazing Grace. He's also one of the most important people in William Wilberforce's life. William Wilberforce was instrumental in eradicating the slave trade from England. So that's John Newton. That's the John Newton that Cooper knew. Newton was Cooper's pastor and friend for over 40 years. He would often take Cooper on long walks. He would often take him to do ministry visits. He worked on hymns with him. He wrote poetry with him. And he eventually moved away, but for 20 years, he wrote letters to Cooper. Newton was constantly reminding Cooper of God's grace, of God's love, and of God's goodness. He also pushed Cooper when he needed pushed and would point out sin in his life. John Newton probably saved Cooper's physical life and was used by God to save his eternal spiritual life. This is why we emphasize relationships so much in our church. This is why we preach it up here so often. This is why we have things like the 10-minute break. You can sneak in late to service. You can streak out of here early as the service ends. But during that 10-minute break, unless you hide in the bathroom, which I think some of you do, you're going to have to talk to somebody at some point, whether it's this week, whether it's next week, whether it's a month down the road. That break is designed for you to meet people and engage in relationships. This is why we emphasize and encourage life groups and retreats and volunteer teams and classes. We do this because there are some of you here who can identify strongly with the darkness that Cooper walked through. And there are some of you who haven't made up your mind about what you believe. There are some of you who maybe have been hardened by the deceitfulness of sin, and you don't know you've been deceived. Biblical relationships involve encouragement and urging and warning, and those are things that God uses to help us persevere. Engaging in those relationships, it's hard for some people. It can be messy. It can be painful. For some of us, it goes against our nature. I will admit, I am not a big people person. I'll be honest with you about that. It's difficult for me and even painful at some times for me to meet new people and then eventually bare my soul to them and let them actually get to know who I am. There is a part of me that would rather sit in my seat during the 10-minute break. There is a part of me that would rather sit at home during the week and not go to life group. There's a part of me that wants to avoid retreats and things like that because it's large gatherings of people for a long period of time and it is draining to me. But I know that the consequence of avoiding intimate biblical relationships is far worse than a little bit of social awkwardness and emotional drainage. I know that God has given me relationships to encourage me, to urge me, to point out sin in my life, and I know he has called me to do the same for others, to encourage others, to point out sin in my friends' lives. The price of relationships is time, energy, emotions, maybe money, and probably more. But the price of avoiding relationships, the price of isolation, is quite possibly separation from God forever. On the positive side, it has been my experience, and probably many of yours as well, that the encouragement that I receive when I go to retreats, when I show up at life group, when I come here on Sunday mornings, far outweighs whatever I have to pay to engage in those things. I am sure that it took a toll on John Newton to care for a man who today we would probably diagnose as clinically insane. But the toll was worth it for him, and God used him to save a man's life. My next point is this. We need encouragement. We need encouragement to shine a light on sin. We need encouragement to shine a light on sin. We need biblical community to point out areas where we have been deceived by sin and then encourage us to change. Notice that the author, he doesn't just warn against sin itself. He warns against the deceitfulness of sin. Sin is tricky. It tells us that it is more valuable, more preferable than righteousness. It makes excuses, and it tries to validate certain actions and behaviors. Sometimes people know that certain action behaviors are wrong, and they still do it. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about people who do things, who act certain ways, and they think it's okay, and they have been completely deceived. That's where encouragement and warning comes in. We need other people. We need other people to be in our lives to point out the areas that we are blind to. If you are isolated and don't engage in relationships where you can be challenged, you will be hardened by sin's deceitfulness. By very definition, you don't know you're deceived. You are blind to it. If you are driving and there is a car in your blind spot, and you go to switch lanes, you either need someone in your car to yell at you, you need somebody in the opposite car to honk at you, or you need to actually finally see the car when it comes out of your blind spot. Or if you have a mom like mine, she'll do the or maybe you have a car that has features that tell you when there's a car in your blind spot, but I'm young and poor, so I don't know what that's like. The point being, you need somebody outside of yourself to alert you to the danger. You are blind to it. And everyone has blind spots. Everybody has areas where they could use an occasional kick in the pants. Even Peter needed this. Peter and Paul, two of the giants of our faith who planted the early church, and they had to do this. Galatians 2, 1 through 11, Paul says, "When Cephas," that's Peter, "came to Antioch, I opposed him to his face because he stood condemned. For before certain men came from James, he used to eat with the Gentiles. But when they arrived, he began to draw back and separate himself from the Gentiles because he was afraid of those who belonged to the circumcision group." Basically, Peter was living in fear of the elite religious Jews, and he started disassociating himself from non-Jewish Christians to impress these people, and Paul wasn't having it. Everyone, including Jesus' own disciples, needed someone in their life to point out their blind spots. My third observation is this, that there are different types of encouragement. The two main ones I'll be focusing on are pats on the back and kicks in the pants. So in our office, smart people tend to get teased. When somebody uses a big word or like says a smart phrase or says something, somebody, usually Jeremy or Jordan, will go like this and pretend to push their glasses up their nose, and then they'll repeat it in a derogatory tone. So in a united stand against that kind of behavior, I want everybody to point straight ahead. Do it, please. Point straight ahead. Now point back at your nose. Now push your glasses up your nose, because we're going to get a little nerdy here. Not just a little, and it'll be short, I promise. So the Greek word here is translated encourage or exhort. And there's a broad range, and we need that broad range. The most common way it's translated is exhort, which just means to strongly encourage, to urge. For example, I am constantly exhorted to make coffee for my bosses. Other ways this word is translated, again, warn or plead. It's the kind of language you would think of a good coach using. It's not mean. It's not derogatory. It's not even angry necessarily, but it is passionate. It's compelling. It's inspiring. This word also means to simply encourage, to affirm, to uplift somebody. Again, sometimes the kind of encouragement we need is like a pat on the back. It's a compliment. It affirms something about us, or it explains to us something about who God is that uplifts us. It reminds us, like John Newton did, that God is good, that he is full of grace and love. Other times we need the kind of encouragement that's like a loving kick in the pants. We need to be urged, we need to be pushed and exhorted to take a step of faith, to fight against a specific sin, to serve God. All of this helps us persevere in faith. Every one of those types of encouragement is God's way of helping us persevere. So let me do a little bit of encouraging of my own here. Be able to give and receive both types of encouragement. I think it's easier to give pats on the back. You know, there's a similar phrase, similar saying that goes, I scratch your back, you scratch mine. And that's usually how it goes. And that's a good thing. Complimenting one another, affirming one another is good. At the same time, it's a little more difficult to give a kick in the pants because the same logic applies there. If I kick you in the pants, there's probably a good chance that at some point in the future, you're going to kick me back. Some of you may be like William Cooper. You need more positive reinforcement. You need to be reminded of God's goodness and love and that he has redeemed you. Some of you may be more stubborn, and you need someone to be a good coach and raise their voice at you a little bit and call you out and tell you to work harder and tell you to study your film and tell you to show up on time. We all need to be able to give and receive different kinds of encouragement. It's easy to receive a pat on the back. My encouragement is to take the kick in the pants too and respond humbly and patiently to that person because they probably want what's best for you. Proverbs 27:6 says, wounds from a friend can be trusted, but an enemy multiplies kisses. I would be careful of the person who only gives you pats on the back and never gives you kicks in the pants. Okay, those are my 3 points from the text. Encouragement is life and death. We need each other to persevere through encouragement. We need encouragement to shed a light on sin, and we need all kinds of encouragement. Now I have 3 points of application, and those are simply show up, open up, and then grind it out. Show up, open up, grind it out. First of all, show up. Encouragement cannot happen if we're isolated. If you don't come to church regularly, if you don't show up at Life Group, whether it's in person or on Zoom, if you don't ask somebody to coffee or to come over for dinner, or at least go on a walk or call somebody up during the week, you can't form relationships. You won't find encouragement. And before you downplay the importance of something as simple as showing up, again, the stakes here are life and death. If you think you can do this on your own, let me be the first to tell you that you have already been deceived. Do you know how wolves and lions and other pack predators hunt? They'll either find a solitary animal and attack it together, or they'll attack a herd and they'll separate off one animal from the herd before they all kill it. That's what sin does. There's a famous video from around 2005 that has 82 million views. It's called The Battle at Kruger. In this video, a group of lions has cut off a buffalo from the herd. They literally have their teeth and their claws in it. Eventually, they end up down in the water, and crocodiles get involved. The crocodiles are trying to steal the buffalo from the lions. The lions drag the buffalo back up onto land, and it looks like it's over. Again, they literally have their claws and their teeth in it. They're getting ready to devour this thing. And out of nowhere, the herd shows up and rushes the lions, chases them off, even tosses a couple of them in the air. They showed up. They didn't allow this person or this buffalo to be isolated. And we have to show up for one another to encourage and to be encouraged. If we don't, sin will separate us and sin will devour us. The second application is that you have to open up. We love it that you show up. We love it that you come. If you're doing that, keep doing it. Keep coming. But the next step is to open up. You can come to church. You can come to life group. You can be involved and still be isolated. This is where things get a little bit more painful. This is where you have to be vulnerable. You have to be honest. You have to be willing to let people into your lives. Encouragement is also more powerful when it's more specific. I know this from experience. The encouragement and exhortation that I get from my closest friends is more helpful because they know me. They know my strengths. They know my weaknesses. I've let them into the darkest and brightest parts of my life. So they know exactly what I need to hear. They need to know if I need a pat on the back or if I need a kick in the pants. But I only did that, or that's only helpful because I let them in. One of the ways you open up is just by telling somebody your story. We talk about this all the time. Have somebody over for dinner. Go out to coffee and just exchange life stories. I heard a friend's story just a couple weeks ago, and he told me about how as he started coming to Marysville Grace, another couple invited he and his wife over for dinner and just told them their story. They let them into the trials and triumphs of their life, and it blew this guy away. He had never experienced something like that before, and it played a huge role in his faith and his life. You'd be amazed at how quickly sharing your story can bring you closer with somebody. Don't show up and be alone. You got to open up. The last point, last application, is grind it out. Showing up, opening up, giving encouragement, honestly, does not really mean anything if it doesn't affect life change. Giving and receiving encouragement isn't just supposed to be therapeutic. It's not just supposed to make you feel good, not according to Hebrews 3. Encouragement is given so that we recognize sin and then work to eradicate it. We open up and show up and encourage so that we become more like Christ for the glory of God. Imagine how pointless it would be to get kicked in the pants and then you don't do anything about it. You're just inviting yourself to get kicked more. Make a plan. Write it down. Talk about how you're going to do it and what exactly you're going to do, and then do it. It doesn't mean anything if you don't do anything about the sin that light has been shed upon. Show up, open up, and then grind it out. Work to be more like Christ. We need one another. God has given us a community to encourage us and to help us persevere. Don't ignore that gift. See to it, brothers and sisters, that none of you has a sinful, unbelieving heart that turns away from the living God. But encourage one another daily, as long as it is called today, so that none of you may be hardened by sin's deceitfulness. Let's pray together. God, we thank you that you have designed us for fellowship, that you have made us to share our trials, our triumphs, our hurts, our joys with others, so that we can encourage one another. God, just impress on our hearts the importance of encouragement. Make us know it and understand it. Father, make us feel it and help us to do it. Father, we do this all for your sake. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you.
debt is paid. The cross has overthrown the grave. For Jesus' blood that sets us free means death to death and life for me. The innocent judge guilty.
Let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the end draw near. Hebrews 10, 24 through 25. Thanks, church. We'll see you next week.
I give my heart.